Krishna. Now. So I said, if to know even one thing was to know too much, if to know even one thing was to know too much, what is it that you know when you know nothing? I know it sounds very confusing in a way, it could be, you see, but fundamentally what I'm pointing you to is that absent of the need to know effortfully, you see, or to know in time, you see, that which you know effortfully and you know in time, it was not something that you always knew, then for the purposes of satsang, that knowledge can be kept aside. You see? And if you know even one thing that is like that, it is to know too much. Now, when you don't have any knowledge in this time-bound, effortful way, what is it that remains? So look at everything that you think you know, and if it came to you in time, just keep it aside for a moment. And what is it that you're not willing to keep aside? That you can surrender, or you can inquire into the truth of that. Lost in words or with me? So everything that you got to know that you did not know originally, you see, that came to you over a period of time, just leave that aside. It is too much to know. You see? So to get to true self-knowledge, we need to return to simplicity. You see? You cannot return to innocence and simplicity if you know too much. And how much is too much? Even one thing is too much. You see, even the one thing that came to you in time is too much. So let it go. Now, what do you know independent of that time-bound knowledge, independent of that which you picked up as a concept? What remains? Then all your conceptual knowledge is gone. Can you keep the investment in this moment in the false? No, you can't keep it. Can you understand it in your head? So all that came to you in time were just versions of what is, but none of them truly represent what is. Can you take an example? What do you know? Take an example. What do you know?
What you learn.
What, like for example?
Your name or gender, yes. That yes. Your
yes. So for these, it's very clear that it came in time. It was not original to me, so it can be kept aside. Then anything that you feel like is clear, you see, that I know this, it has to be like this. Yeah.
Sensation in the body.
like a sensation in the body. Like, do you know this? I'm not bullying you out of it. No? I'm just asking sincerely. It may sound strong, but I'm just asking sincerely. Can we really say a sensation is in the body? We have some perception that we call the body, and those sensations that we also call the body. But do we really know that it is in this flesh bucket? Can we really say where it is coming from? There's so many examples we've taken in the past, like the, what is it called? The amputee,
phantom
limb, the rubber glove, the rubber glove experiment, where the subject of the experiment, they were asked to keep their hands at a distance like this. And then there was a false hand that was put there, and that other hand was blocked, your real hand, it was just put there. Then for a while, what you do is you stimulate both hands with some feather or brush or something together. And then what happens is that this false rubber hand is poked with a pin, and you can feel the sensation of the pin. Although that which you call your hand was never poked. So our consciousness has the ability to experience whatever sensation, but the causative idea that comes from the body cannot be verified. You see, and we don't have to dispute it, but at least it makes it doubtable, and to make it doubtable is enough. You see, it is our convictions, it is our beliefs which keep us caught up in the limited idea about ourselves. So empty of that which needs belief, empty of that which needs conviction, what is it that is apparent to you?